Hello, and welcome to the TI Precision Lab discussing op-amp slew rate, Part 3. In this video, we'll take a deeper look at the transition from small signal to large signal response. We will also look at how gain impacts small signal and large signal response. Finally, we will introduce the concept of op-amp overload recovery. In the previous videos on slew rate, we discussed small signal and large signal output response. However, the way in which a circuit operates is not always fully large signal or small signal. In this section, we will discuss the transition between these two operating conditions. Here we have a simple op-amp circuit configured as a non-inverting buffer. We'll apply a range of input steps from 10 millivolts peak to peak to 4 volts peak to peak and observe the output. A transient simulation done in TINA TI will allow us to observe whether the circuit shows small signal or large signal behavior. This figure illustrates the output of the non-inverting buffer circuit from the previous slide versus different input step sizes. Notice that the output rise time is a constant 20 nanoseconds for input steps of 10 millivolts to 250 millivolts. Because the rise time is constant, we know that the response is small signal. The device in this example, the OPA192, has a slew rate of 20 volts per microsecond. You can see that the rate of change for the small step response is lower than the slew rate. Also notice that the output signal increases exponentially for the small signal response, as opposed to the linear increase for amplifiers that are slew rate limited. For input steps between 500 millivolts and 1 volt, the amplifier is transitioning between small signal and large signal response. In this region, the rise time is no longer constant. However, the amplifier is not yet at the full slew rate of 20 volts per microsecond. For input steps greater than 1 volt, the amplifier is slew rate limited. You can see that the rate of change of the output signal is at the slew rate limit of about 20 volts per microsecond. Also, notice that the output signal increases linearly in response to the input step. In this example, input signals less than 250 millivolts caused a small signal response, and signals greater than 1 volt caused a large signal response. However, this transition depends on the amplifier's design and technology. CMOS amplifiers tend to reach slew limit for signals greater than 100 millivolts, and bipolar amplifiers can slew limit at even lower input voltages. Note that the industry standard for small signal response is a 100 millivolt step, but in practice, the actual limit may be lower. Because of the way the output signal is scaled in this figure, it is possible to be tricked into thinking that the slew rate limited signal at the bottom of the figure is moving more slowly than the small signal response at the top of the figure. This is not the case, and the next slide will provide further clarification. The left-hand side of this slide shows the small signal response to a 100 millivolt input signal in green, and the large signal response to a 4 volt input signal in blue. The plots are scaled such that the two output signals have equal height. This makes the small signal response look like it is moving faster than the large signal response. On the right, we combine the two responses to emphasize that the large signal response is slew rate limited and is changing much faster than the small signal response. In fact, the large signal response is changing at 19.8 volts per microsecond, and the small signal response is only changing at 5 volts per microsecond. Let's take a closer look at the output of the non-inverting buffer circuit with a 10 volt step applied to the input. In this case, the device is in slew rate limit of 20 volts per microsecond. However, when the signal approaches the final value of 10 volts, the op-amp will transition to a small signal response. Zooming in on the last 300 millivolts of output signal swing, you can see that the rate of change of the output decreases from approximately the slew rate of 20 volts per microsecond to a lower rate of change, such as approximately 5 volts per microsecond. Also, you can see that the shape of the output changes from the linear rise associated with slew rate limit to the exponential behavior associated with small signal response. Most of the examples discussed thus far have been basic buffer circuits, also called unity gain followers. Now let's look at amplifiers with different closed-loop gains in order to see the effect that closed-loop gain has on output response. Here we show an inverting amplifier circuit and a gain of minus 99 volts per volt. The input is a small signal step of 20 millivolts peak to peak. Based on the gain, the output should be approximately 2 volts peak to peak. Does the output respond as a small signal or as a large signal? This is the simulated output response of the circuit from the previous slide. Notice that the output signals rise and fall in an exponential way, which indicates a small signal response. Also, if we use the small signal rise time formula, we can see that the calculated rise time of 3.5 microseconds is very close to the simulated rise time of 3.28 microseconds. Thus, the amplifier responds to the 20 millivolt input step as a small signal, and we can conclude that the amplitude of the input signal determines the behavior of the op-amp. The output signal amplitude does not determine whether the response is small signal or large signal. Up to this point, we have considered the small signal and large signal response of signals that are inside the linear range of the amplifier. In other words, we have not violated the input common mode range or the output swing limitations. Now we'll discuss what happens when we drive signals beyond the op-amp's output swing limitations. Driving the output beyond its linear range is called overloading the output. Once the overload condition is corrected, there is a time delay before the overloaded output can recover, called T-overload, and return to its normal linear behavior. In the next few slides, I'll explain overload recovery and show how it relates to small and large signal response. The overload condition occurs when an amplifier is driven beyond its output swing limits. In this example, if the output is driven very close to the positive supply, V+, the output transistor Q1 becomes saturated, while transistor Q2 is nearly cut off. Also notice that transistor Q1 is in the ohmic region of its operating curve, as opposed to the active region where it normally operates. Overload recovery is the time required for all the internal transistors in the output stage to transition from an abnormal state, whether saturated or cut off, to a normal state. Let's simulate the overload condition. In this example, we apply a plus or minus 50 millivolt peak-to-peak square wave to an inverting amplifier and a gain of minus 200 volts per volt. The expected output in this case is plus or minus 10 volts peak-to-peak. Since the power supplies are only plus or minus 2.5 volts, it is clear that the output is driven well beyond the output swing limitations and thus overloaded. In the following slide, we'll look at the simulated transient response, showing how the op-amp recovers from this overload. Here we compare the simulated results from the circuit on the previous page to the measured results given in the device datasheet. In both cases, there is about a 50 microsecond time delay before the output transitions out of the overload condition. In this simulation, the output was heavily overdriven. Next, we will examine how the output responds when we vary the amount of overdrive. This slide shows the response of the same inverting amplifier circuit in a gain of minus 200 volts per volt. The plot on the left shows the response where the output signal remains just inside of the linear response range. Since there is no overload, you can see that there is no overload time delay. Furthermore, the output has the exponential rise and fall behavior associated with a small signal response. The plot on the right shows the response when the output signal is driven just outside the linear response range. As expected, there is an overload time delay. In this case, the delay is 28 microseconds, which is actually shorter than the datasheet specification, because the device is barely in overload. Also notice that the output still has the exponential rise and fall associated with a small signal response. Thus, the amplifier still responds as a small signal amplifier, even though the device is in an overload condition. Next, we'll see that significantly overdriving the output will affect the output response. Continuing on, let's compare the response that is just barely in overload, shown on the left, with one that is significantly overdriven, shown on the right. Notice that the response that is just barely in overload still has a small signal response, as mentioned on the last slide. The response for this case is exponential, and the rate of change of the output signal is very small compared to the slew rate. The response on the right shows that when the output is significantly overdriven, the output will slew. Because we are significantly overdriving the output, a large input offset voltage, VOS, is developed even with a relatively small input signal, which causes the output to slew. That concludes this video. Thank you for watching. Please try the quiz to check your understanding of this video's content.